I made sure I got a new bag. I made sure I got a new pencil case. I got new uniforms. I got a new toy. I played with Dobson. I cleaned my room. I bought new bed sheets. I completed all my assignments. But there's something that I was keeping in my mind specially to do in August. And what was that? I mean, holidays are over. I mean, all my list is done, so I guess I'm happy. But I feel like I forgot something that is specifically supposed to be done during August. I forgot to fly kites! Now what do I do it? Now for the next 3 months I have to be studying. I can't fly kites now. Well, that's a good thing that the school, you know, holiday is over. Dobson! Finally spends a couple of hours in the school, so that's great. I get to have a little bit of peace to myself. But wait, no. Her school finishes at 1:30. Mine finishes at 1:45. If anything, she's having 15 minutes extra for herself. Oh! To change something up, I really hope my questions bring a little bit of cheer to me. I really do hope that. So, questions? Okay. I'm not crying because of the questions. I'm crying because I didn't get to fly kite. Okay. Question number one. Name the biggest cement producers of the world. Option number one, Lafarge, France. Option number two, China National Building Materials. Option number three, Taiwan Cement. They're asking about cement producers. I don't work with cement. I don't know. So let's go check out what the correct answer is. Is it the cement producers of Lafarge, France, China National Building Materials, or Taiwan Cement?
The answer is
Lafarge, France.
Oh, it's Lafarge, France. Now I remember. Okay. Now, question number two. There is only one continent on the Earth that doesn't have any desert. Which is that continent? Option number one,
Asia.
Option number two,
Europe.
Option number three,
Australia.
Is it Asia, Europe, or Australia? Asia has deserts. Deserts, let me come up with name. Oh yeah, there's stuff like Gulab Jamun. Then there are stuff like, say for example, if you take Sri Lanka, we have milk toffees. We have desserts like ice cream. We have desserts like, you know, those sweet drinks. And we have different sorts of, you know, desserts such as Watalapam. We have desserts. Australia, I assume, also has desserts. Maybe they have crepe cakes. They have different sorts of other cakes. Europe also has cakes and stuff. So I guess all these countries have desserts. So this question is therefore wrong. Yeah, I mean, all continents in the world have deserts. What other desert could they be meaning? If, you know, it's an obvious answer that every country has desserts. Every continent has desserts. Oh, they're talking about the desert where it's warm in the morning and very cold in the, you know, not the afternoon, but at night. Okay. Asia has one of those as well. I mean, Asia has a couple of those. Australia also has deserts, as far as I can remember. But I've never come across a desert in Europe. So I'm going to go for, you know, a lucky guess here and say that the answer is option number two, Europe.
The answer is
Europe.
I was correct. even though if it's lucky days. So I got a little bit of facts for you. Deserts today occupy about 1/5 of the total area of Earth's land. That's like, you know, 1/5. That's a lot of, you know, the Earth's land, which is apparently deserts. So they are mostly in Asia, Africa, Australia, North America, and South America. The reason as to why there are no deserts in Europe is because there are different sorts of factors that actually prevents Europe from having any deserts. You know, not the eating one, but the very warm one. So that's why, what else does it say? Oh yeah, the fact is that Europe is located too far from the northern tropical circle, and therefore the equator. Now, usually tropical countries are countries which lie closer to the equator. You know, the equator is that imaginary line which goes all across the earth. Equator, so Sri Lanka is close to the equator, therefore we have a country which is kind of warm at all times. So Europe is far away from the equator, thereby it is assumed that they won't be having the, you know, factual ability to have deserts. Not the eating type, the, you know, very warm type. So they don't have relatively warm water bodies in Europe. And yeah, those are the kind of things. And also it's a continent with very heavy rainfall. So you can't have deserts when there's rainfall. Then it turns into a rainforest. So that's why Europe does not have it. So in conclusion, there are one fifth of the Earth's land is covered by deserts. So they're deserts. Most of them are at Asia, Australia, South America, North America, and Africa. One of the reasons why the Europe does not have deserts is the fact that it is quite away from the northern tropical circle and also the equator, and also the fact that it does not have relatively warm water bodies, and the fact that they have high and heavy rainfalls in the continent, in Europe. Thereby, it stops them from having deserts. So, there you go. Moving on to our third question. How many baby kangaroos are usually born at a time to a single mother? Well, kangaroos are huge, almost the size of, bigger than the size of human babies. And the options are 1, 2, 3. Now I'm not counting, it's just like option 1, 1, option 2, 2, option 3, 3. Like 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6, 6, 7, 7, 8. I'm going off track. Anywho, so usually when it comes to human babies as well, it's one. And you know, one of those special times, it's, you know, twins, triplets, quadruples, it just goes on and on. But that's on rare occasions. So I'm going to go for option number one, one kangaroo at a time.
The answer is one.
I was correct. And a quick fact for you. What do you call baby kangaroos? It's joy. That's what a baby kangaroo is called, a joy. Okay. All right. Okay, three questions done. See, remember how I told you I forgot to, you know, fly kites? Yeah? I'm going to try and ask my mother whether I can, you know, make a kite now and try and send it. Of course, I have to complete my questions, but then I'll just go ask her now. Okay. So, until I go and get permission from my mom, you stay right there. Freeze. I'm back. And now we're happy. Because my mom said if I finish up all my six questions, she just might let me, you know, make a kite for myself. So let's go on to the fourth question and get this over with. Okay. What is the most commonly broken bone in the human body?
Number one, jawbone. Number two, staples. Number three, clavicle.
See, I've never broken my jawbone. No, haven't I broken, no have I broken a staples, and I haven't broken a clavicle. So, I technically haven't broken any bones. Except, of course, when it comes to chicken bones. You know. Not really sure. You know what? Let's go together and find the answer.
The answer is
clavicle.
The clavicle. So apparently it is known as the collarbone and located between the shoulder and the front of the neck, and it is actually the most likeliest to get broken, because you know whenever you have a fracture in your shoulder, it's most likely that your clavicle is broken. So that's why it's more common to be broken. Okay.
Fifth question, one before the last. What is the full form of VIP?
You know, especially whenever you go for stuff, they're like, move, 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 the VIPs are arriving. We're like, who? So yeah, very, very important people. Okay, what is the full form of VIP? Very important person, very impressive person, very intelligent person. Person, 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 person. See? Not a lot of people who passed me that they were intelligent, I know that for a fact. They weren't very impressive either, but I guess they're important. So I'm gonna go with option number one, very important person.
The answer is
very important person.
Very important person. You know, see, the thing about very important people, a very important person, is the fact that anyone could be a very important person. For example, if you take the whole country, the country as a whole, it could be government officials, ministers, the president, the vice president, the prime minister, whoever it could be. When it comes to schools, maybe the principal, the chairman, the vice principals, headmistresses, teachers, and my dear friends. I'm just kidding. But those important characters when it comes to anything. It should not always be local. It could be foreign dignitaries as well. So whenever they come to Sri Lanka, they will be treated as very important people because they come over to Sri Lanka to visit or they want to attend a certain event. So they become very important people. You too could be VIPs for a sort of an event where you are the star of the day, where you are the most important person. Then you automatically turn into a very important person. And you always know, all of you are VIPs for me. You know why? Because you helped me a lot. So you're very, very important. Alright? Okay. Fifth question, let's go. Okay. Oh, sixth question. Final question, let's go. What is this beautiful place called? Vroom. Is it the Ambarke Devale? Is it the Gadaladeniya Temple? Or is it the Lankathilaka Temple? I have seen this before. Because we did a lot of questions. I am going to go with question number six, I mean the answer, to be option number three, Lankathilaka Temple.
The answer is
Lankathilaka Temple.
I've got facts.
Let's go.
Lankathilaka Vihara is an ancient Buddhist temple situated in Udunura of Kandy, Sri Lanka. It is located on Daulakala Road, approximately 4 kilometers, that is 2.5 miles, away from Pirimathalava Junction and a few kilometers from the ancient Buddhist temple Gadaladeniya Vihara. It is considered as the most magnificent agricultural edifice created during the Gampola era. The history of the temple goes back to the 14th century. According to historical reports, this temple was built by King Buanakabahu IV, who reigned from 1341 to 1351 AD. He entrusted the construction of this temple to his chief minister. Name? Give me a second. Sena Lankadikara. Who successfully finished the works of this temple. The architecture of the temple was designed by a South Indian architect named, again give me a minute, Satapati Rayar. Satapati Rayar. Satapati Rayar. Correct. According to the professor Senarath Paranavitharana, Satapati Rayar designed this temple using Sinhalese architecture of Polonnaruwa era and also with other Dravidian and Indo-Chinese architectural patterns. Oh, big words. So this architecture who is from South India designed this temple using Sinhalese architecture of Polonnaruwa era and also with other Dravidian and Indo-Chinese architectural patterns. There's more. The Vihara building have been built on a natural rock. I am getting little problem with my tongue. We are facing technical difficulties. Hold on. Back. The Vihara building have been built on a natural rock called Panhalgal rock. Among the buildings, the image house possesses characteristically outstanding architectural features, embellished with traditional Sinhalese sculptures. According to the facts recorded in the Lanka Tilaka copper plate, this image house was constructed as a four-story mansion with height of 80 feet. But today, only three stories can be seen. The walls and the ceiling of the image house has been adorned with the Candian era paintings and sculptures. Rock curves inscriptions found in the temple premises with both Sinhala and Tamil sections proclaim about the initiators and facilities gifted to this temple by the kings. That was long, with a lot of big words. Hope you understood. In conclusion, this temple is a huge artifact to Sri Lankan history, and thereby we as a younger generation should be having the ability to make sure that these artifacts, our heritage, is protected for the future generations as well. Because when it comes to these buildings, they have their own personality, they have their own characteristics, and we should preserve them to make it more beautiful and more important. To make them VIBs, very important buildings, or very important architecturally important buildings, or very important buildings in short. Okay. Oh, that's the end of the six questions. Yes. Victory dance. All right. So since my six questions are done, I think my mom's gonna let me, make my kite and hopefully. Soar it up high in the sky. Alright, thank you so much for helping me finish off all these six questions. It was great help, and always remember, you are a VIP for me forever. So make sure you send in your questions. If you have any sort of questions or doubts or anything else you want to know, send all of that over to my house. My house address is right over there. Copy it down and send me. Also, don't forget, you can add my mom's number. She's right over there. You can use it for WhatsApp or Viber and talk to me or my mom through it. It could be my dad's number, because my mom and dad, they kind of switch phones once in a while. So it could be either. And don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. And just in case you missed a couple of my questions, don't forget to go over to our, YouTube channel and subscribe. Alright, so till I come back with more questions, make sure you keep updated. Find more questions for me and be right there next time, because I need your help. With that, Tavi out!